On this episode of Hot Rod Hoarders, we're taking a deep dive into the history of the Rebel Rouser drag car. This is a 1932 Plymouth coupe with Ford power. It was last raced in 1969 and then passed around to a few different owners. Luckily, the son of the original builder was able to track it down and buy it, and then restore the car as the ultimate tribute to his father's racing days. Before I get too carried away, I want to encourage you to hit that subscribe button if you haven't already, give me a thumbs up if you like this video, and leave me a comment down below. This car's drag racing history dates back to about the late 50s, and that's when Denzel Rader bought this car. Now, he was from Winchester, Kentucky, and he's actually a Ford guy, so kind of odd to end up with a Plymouth, but it allowed him to do what he wanted to do, and that was go drag racing. As he got a little more serious about drag racing, the 361 Edsel engine got dual quads. The car's next engine was based off of a 390 cubic inch engine out of a 1962 Ford Thunderbird. From there, the car went through a series of changes. Basically, it never stopped evolving until the car was finished racing in 1969. But let's take a look at some of the early setups on this car. So you'll see the dual quad setup on it. You'll see the cheater slicks with the really cool little tread pattern. It's got reverse steel wheels on the back. The car is sitting pretty low compared to what it would have from the factory. And you can see that he's started stripping away some of the bodywork to lighten this thing up and just try to go faster. At this point, the car was running in B altered. And I want to explain just a little bit of that because, you know, this car sort of looks like a gasser. And everybody's definition of gasser is a little bit different, but I want to just nail this down real quick. This car was not a gasser. It never raced as a gasser because it didn't have fenders on it. Fenders was a pretty big rule for gassers, especially, you know, like pre-48 cars that were run in the gas class. They had to have fenders. So this car automatically, by removing the fenders, that puts you into the altered class. In the mid-1960s, this car took on a whole new personality. The 427 lettering on the door went away, and the car got a new repaint and a new name. It was now known as the Rebel Rouser. It wasn't just a shiny new paint job. This thing had a brand new frame replacing the original frame. It had an altered wheelbase. And in some of these old pictures, you can see exactly how they moved those wheel wells and the rear axle forward. And the whole idea with that is to get better weight balance. And back then, the tires were no good, the tracks were no good. So they had to do any trick that they could to put weight on those rear tires. So the way they did that was to shorten up the wheelbase in the back, let a little bit of weight hang off of the back, and then lift the front of the car so that the weight of that engine would be put on the back tires much easier. So you can see the transformation on this car. The stance changed, the paint job changed, everything changed because they were getting really serious with it. Even after that, they took it another step further and pushed the front axle forward several more inches, giving this thing an even more dramatic stance. This new setup on the car actually bumped it out of the altered class and put it into the competition coupe class. And he ran in the B category because of the engine size. You know, he's running up against cars that were basically dragsters with a body hanging off the back. In this picture, you can see Johnson Shell lettered on the hood of the car. And that's actually where Denzel built this thing. He got a lot of help from his brother, Shirley. And actually, Shirley ended up being the prominent driver of the car for a few years. And then other drivers included Logan Painter and Tommy Johnson. To my knowledge, the car never left the state of Kentucky. It raced at places like Clay City, Manchester Drag Strip, Bluegrass Dragway, but never really went to any giant national events or anything like that. By 1967, Denzel was ready to get out of drag racing altogether, so he sold the car to a guy named Vernon Bradley, who then sold it to Melvin Taylor. Melvin went by the nickname Snooky, and he took this car to the next level as if it could get any wilder, and he put a 427 cubic inch single overhead cam Ford motor in it, the ultimate drag racing engine of the 60s. And with the new camera in it, the car ran its best time ever, a 932 at 144 miles per hour. The car was last raced in 1969, and then Snooky sort of parted it out, and he ended up selling the body and chassis to Larry Cummings. By this point, the car actually had a new frame under it. Instead of the small round tube frame, it had a rectangular tube frame, but luckily, they left the 46 Ford front axle, the original spring, and the original radius rods. While Larry owned it, he started doing some metal work, and he filled in those holes in the cowl panel where the exhaust headers used to poke through. He also put a slick firewall in it, but ultimately he ended up selling the car to Lonnie Dillingham in 1999. Lonnie had intentions of continuing the metalwork and getting this thing back roadworthy again. He was actually wanting to make a street rod out of it, and I'm glad he never got around to it because that would have completely wiped the racing history away from this car. And so it ended up sitting in Lonnie's barn for several years. That's when Denzel's son, Dwayne Rader, came into the picture. Dwayne had heard about this car. He had heard stories about it. He had heard his father and his uncle Shirley talk about this car for basically his whole life, but he had never seen it in person. He had seen a few old pictures of it, but it really got his curiosity going because Dwayne's a car guy, and he really wanted to find this thing. So he started working to track it down, and he found Lonnie. He got to go look at the car, and he was able to go buy it. Even though this car didn't look like much, it had a lot of original stuff still attached to it. That included the 1946 Ford front axle, which still had the chrome plating on it from the 1960s. Dwayne added some round tubing, some braces, and gussets to that rectangular tube frame. First of all, that adds some strength. Second of all, it also makes this thing look more like the original frame. He had to make a few changes to the rear suspension, but he kept it period correct and he made it functional so that he could go drag race this thing when he got it done. The modern engine setup in this car is rowdy. It's got a FE-based motor. It started as 427 cubic inch, but they put a 428 crank in it, which brought the stroke up and made it a 460 cubic inch combination. They put a set of Dove SK medium riser cylinder heads on it, a Dove tunnel wedge intake manifold, two 660 four-barrel carburetors, and it's got a huge mechanical camshaft in it that sounds awesome through those open headers. Dwayne handled most of the work in his home garage, but had help from guys like Raymond Borders, who did the body work, Mitch Lewis painted it, and then Kirby Stafford handled all the hand lettering on it. When it came to tires and wheels, Dwayne spared no expense to put this car back to the original mid-60s setup. He put a set of Magnesium American Racing 12-spoke spindle mount wheels on the front. They've got ProTrack 560-15 bi-supply tires. Out back, it's got 15x8-inch reverse steel wheels with pie crust slicks for the perfect look. Dwayne put the finishing touches on this car in the summer of 2015, just in time to make it to the Hot Rod Reunion in Bowling Green, Kentucky. Unfortunately, about a month after the car's big debut in Bowling Green, Denzel Rader passed away. Now, he had been fighting some health issues, but he held on just long enough to see the car finished. And that meant the world to Dwayne to be able to show him his hard work and show him, you know, how much he cared about this old car and the memories that he was able to create in it. Since finishing the restoration, Dwayne has taken this thing all over the place. He's taken it to Bowling Green, Kentucky. He's taken it to Byron, Illinois to the Meltdown Drags. He's taken it to all sorts of different nostalgia-themed events and car shows. And, you know, he's just continuing to tell this car's story, spreading those memories of his dad and his uncle and all those other guys that owned it and raced it all through the years. You know, it's a really meaningful car. It's got a ton of great history. The coolest thing to me is that he actually gets out and drag races this car. He goes out and runs it hard, and it brings a smile to people's face when they see this thing in motion going down the track. Even though Dwayne is too young to have actual memories of this car in its heyday, he's out there making new memories with it every time he takes it to the track or to a car show. And if I had to guess, I'd say the Rebel Rouser will get passed down through many generations in the Rader family and continue being able to tell the story of this wild and crazy drag car from the 60s. That's it for this one. Stay tuned for another new video next week. Thank you for watching.